Okay, welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. After a five-month hiatus, right? This is Blown Speakers, episode 74. I'm Dave Hoenigman, coming in from Yokohama, Japan, and Greg Genco is coming in from Buffalo. Hello, Greg.
Hey, Dave. Good to be back.
Today we have a very special guest, also coming in from Buffalo, Walter Kemp III. Welcome, Walter.
Hey, how you doing? Thank you.
Go ahead, Greg.
Yeah, and I'd like to, you know, we always have big music fans on Blown Speakers. And we've got a big music fan here, but I think it's unusual we have the caliber of musician that we have with us tonight with Walter Kemp III.
Bless you. Thank you.
Walter, I was just thinking this week as I was getting ready for the show, I was trying to recount the times I've seen you perform. And the first time was a Mardi Gras party.
Oh, wow.
With Mr. Desiree.
Yeah, Frank.
Mr. Frank Desiree. And you and the band. I'm not sure if it was Walter Kemp 3-0 or the Walter Kemp Trio. But
it was a 3-0. Then we had even a trombone player with us. We had, what's the name of that cat? Sean West. He's from L.A. He was with us.
All right.
Yeah. And Frank was there. And then we had Rashawn O'Dell on bass. And we had David Jonathan on drums.
Okay.
So it was a 3-0 plus 2. Huh?
You had masks on.
Yeah, we did the whole, you know.
Yeah, it was a party vibe, and you guys sounded great. It was fun. It was on a weeknight.
But
it felt like a weekend.
It did.
And then a different, a whole different vibe was with. When you were doing the Ray Scott tribute.
Oh, wow.
I don't want to mess up the name of the band, Revolution.
Yeah, the Revolution.
And you guys were dressed up again, but in tribute to the orchestra. And,
yeah.
That was at Hall Walls. And that was great as well. That was a real orchestrated thing. That was a real nice night.
Good times.
And then, again, Walter Kemp, 3-0 with Mr. Desiree. Last summer, you did a little over a year ago, you did a benefit for Haiti.
That was actually Frank's band. It was Frank's idea. Okay. He had just came back from Europe, and you know he's in and out of Europe. And he's like, "Hey man, let's do something." I said, "Okay, well, what do you want to do?" And he said, "Let's get together and rehearse and see." So I caught up. I think Bernard was in that band. Bernard Kuntz.
Yes.
Bernard Kuntz, Odell, and Frank. And depending on when you saw me, I had Ravi Papanaba with us. It depended on when you saw me.
It was at the Sportsman's, so.
So no, we didn't have a drummer. We had Odell hit the drum with his foot while he's playing bass. Yeah.
But it sounded good.
That was Frank's band. I think he was singing all the Haitian.
Right.
Yep.
Yes. Uh huh. Yeah, so another, different but equally enjoyable night of music. And then most recently, again, another thing with the Blacksmiths as part of the festival, Colored Musicians International Jazz Festival, down in the basement at Hall Walls.
Ninth Ward,
that's, yes. And you jammed with those guys.
Yep. And those guys just got a European deal with Swamp Booking, Swamp something. They're out of, I I want to say Copenhagen. Don't quote me. They just got it this week.
Okay, so wow.
European booking deal. And they're both, I believe they're both playing for the Winter Jazz Fest, or maybe just Luke. But Winter okay. Jazz Fest is coming up. You know, in New York, they do it like, it's one of the, you know, when APAP is going on, I go there a lot every year just to either I'm promoting a project, you know. But in fact, every time I'm there promoting a project, it was the first time I was invited was when I did the 3-0 and we came, we did our first project. But then ever since then, we would go there and promote a project. Last time I was promoting Black Hole. And
okay.
Yeah, this time, yeah. So yeah, that, actually I wasn't promoting Black Hole. Take it back. It was the version before Black Hole. It was Kemp and the Revelation.
But okay.
But yeah, those guys are cool.
And I haven't seen you with Black Hole, but I'm looking forward
to that. Oh yeah, and that music is improvised, and only the pieces that are it's like maybe only like two pieces that I composed them, but everything else is improvised, and we just go for it.
Yeah, nice.
Yeah.
You sent us some samples, so maybe we can play some of that.
Yeah, some quick snippet samples,
give everybody a taste. How about we talk a little bit about your bio a little more in detail? So, Dave, if you could, slide number 3.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, let me just mention on the way to that. Okay. We're going to talk about Thelonious Monk's 1968 album Underground today. But yeah, let me move forward to just a moment there. Okay. Okay, Greg.
Oh, and the next slide, Dave.
Okay.
Oh, and
I got you.
Well, there's our guest, Walter Kemp, 3. And just so everybody at home knows, as I said, Walter is a very accomplished musician. In fact, V-Count endorsed artist. And this is something I learned recently, Walter. You owe much to your father, the classical and gospel composer, who sparked your early interest in piano. Yeah. And seeing and hearing your father's compositions performed at Carnegie Hall opened your eyes to a world of music.
That's my dad. He's right now he's living down in Houston, but yeah, he moved us to New York early 80s for a few years, and then we came back.
So how old were you when his music was performed at Carnegie Hall?
Well, we actually were living in Buffalo. He got the I believe he got a commission to do some. It was a gospel concert, and they took some of his music in Carnegie Hall. I was about 13, 14, so I don't know. I would have to say maybe somewhere around 90, 91, somewhere around there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow. And then, so you started studying classical piano, and after brief interest in the drums, moved into jazz while still playing gospel organ.
It kind of all just weirdly happening. I quit music when I went to college. I got an undergrad degree in mathematics. So at that point, I never really listened to jazz. And I was dating this beautiful woman who's now my wife. Mm-hmm. And she was listening to Coltrane. And I was like, what is that? Miles, Sketch of Spain. And she was listening to Not actually, not Monk at that time. She was listening to other stuff. So I got into it by listening. I think actually one of my first album was I Love Supreme, and then from there was Sketches of Spain with Miles, and then it just kept growing and growing. And they had I listened without playing. And then finally after school, I just started. I had wanted to play piano again. I don't know why.
And that's,
yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Nice. All right.
What did you listen to before your wife kind of turned you on to jazz?
I was a kid. So it was hip hop, of course. R&B. Grew up on gospel. I knew every gospel probably up until the mid 90s. When I decided, I went to Black College down in Richmond, Virginia, Virginia University, and down there is where I stopped going to so much church, and I stopped listening to some other things, and just got an interest in jazz, and you know, from there it just went. And then I started actually going to jazz concerts. This thing on Mondays called the Devil's Workshop. It was like hip. It was started like around 10, and Dana was like her first year of teaching. We were down in Virginia, and she would be grading her papers like at 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock at night while we're listening to this band. And it was done in the back room. You had to go through the restaurant down, and they had a huge back room. You're like, you felt like you were in New York. So it was a great
time. Oh, man. Nice.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, so that led you to being a lead composer, pianist for the Walter Kemp Trio, Kemp and the Revelation, and most recently, the Black Hole.
Yeah.
And for the folks at home, you have collaborated with such luminaries as Junie Booth. Am I saying her name correctly?
Junie, absolutely.
Yeah.
And, you know Junie.
From Sun Ra.
Not only from some, from everywhere. Jazz messengers. His list goes on and on and on. Yeah, he played with a little bit of everybody.
Okay. Bobby Militello.
Yeah.
Another Buffalonian, play with Dave Brubeck, and Sabu Adeyola.
Yeah.
We'll play with Ahmad Jamal.
Yeah, that's one of his notable. He did D.D. Bridgewater. He did a lot of.
Okay. Oh, all right.
Yeah, these cats, like, you know, Junie's a super heavyweight. Like, the kids down in New York worshipped him because he played with everybody. And then, you know, Bobby's definitely a heavyweight. Sabu's definitely a heavyweight. Ray Scott was a heavyweight. You know, they did, you know, they went to New York. You know, Bobby got picked up right out of Buffalo too. And Sabu did, and then went and lived in New York. So, yeah.
All right. So, yeah, well, welcome. And, bring in some real knowledge, some real talent to our broadcast. So thank you.
Yeah.
Oh, you're welcome.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Dave, can we pause for a second?
Yeah. Did you want to say something about this photo, Greg?
Yes. And you paused it?
No. No. Okay, I will.
Did you guys know? All right,
Greg, I'm pausing now.
Okay. We're back, ladies and gentlemen. And full disclosure, I was just a little bit embarrassed that I didn't really know who Junie Booth was and referred to Junie Booth as that Walter had collaborated with her rather than him. But we're moving forward.
Well, yeah, you know, Judy's one of the cats, you know, like he's played with the Jazz Messengers. He's played with McCoy Tyner. He's played with Dexter Carter. You know, the list goes on and on and on. When he was 16, I mean, I believe Judy graduated from high school. I don't know, because he was on tour. Like, he literally would skip school, take a train to Rochester, Cleveland, Pittsburgh, and play. Like, he was that good. He was that good. And Judy went through a lot. He lost, I believe, he lost his father early.
Okay.
And, so he, you know, but he was super, super, super talented. And I forget when he comes back to town. Matter of fact, this is one of the shirts I got right here from Judy. That's so Buffalo. You probably can't even see it, right? I wear it, you know, because I don't know. Some sort of ancestral connection. But long story short, I'm playing it. I'm the first time I've ever released anything on my own. First time I've ever released anything on a label, Blue Jazz out of Chicago. We're doing a CD release here. We're going to be doing a tour. So, you know, we're going to Philly, Toronto, blah, blah, blah. And I'm playing and I'm done. And Junie's like, instead of being like, yeah, man, that was good. He was like, why don't you listen to Bobby Timmons? I didn't even know what to say. I was just like, but as I listened to Bobby, I can definitely hear, you know, the gospel in it and the soulfulness in it. I was like, oh, this is where this is coming. Bobby Timmons, you know, he's one of the cats. So, yeah. Mm.
All right.
Like that.
Oh, and then. And here's.
Oh, I got it.
Oh, there we go. Thanks, Dave. Yeah. So this is it looks a fairly recent photo, yeah. Walter.
Yeah. I was actually in the city working on this Black Hole album, and it a great photographer by the name of Kasha Izgazowski. I probably messed up your name, Kasha. I'm so sorry. And she's incredible, and we just had this idea of me sitting in the middle of the street, and I'm just hoping that I wouldn't die. So she's rushing me up at the last minute, and yeah, so yeah, she's great.
And you were saying you thought it was maybe 7th Avenue.
I believe it's 7th, because now, literally off 7th, like 29th is his office, or the studio, and then right there is the, Penn Station. So
okay.
Yeah, I believe that was 7.
Got the shot. For the what do you call the typologists at home, those into type, you'll notice I use the Broadway font to print out Walter's name there. Broadway, New York City. While it's on 7th Broadway, you know. Thinking of New York City.
Yeah.
So that's cool. All right. Well, should we get into the album?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay. All right. Thelonious Monk, the High Priest of Bebop, right? Well, one question I'd like to ask just right away is why did you choose this album out of all the Thelonious albums? Why this one?
Well, this particular album, for one thing, Thelonious, I think I have a lot of similarities with him, other than his, you know, dealing with his, you know, his mental struggles. But, you know, he was he played this American art form. You know, he liked to smoke a cigar or a cigarette and drink a little bit. He liked a little bit of guns, and he loved music, you know. So, you know, the whole cover, I was actually searching for it, and I've seen it before, and then my wife got me a reissue for Christmas. So, but it called to me. And then some of the things, the music itself caused me. I mean, like he, on Thelonious, the song, he's like, dum, 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 dum. He's going like, right, you can hear it. He's going down the scale. It's something I would do, you know? And then he's got like a blue, like he takes simple, like foundation, and he just has it just himself complex because of himself, you know? And if you don't watch him play, On some of the tunes, you think he's playing. He think that's his right hand and his left hand comping. And he's going over with his left hand, playing the solo in his left hand, and he's comping in his right. It's like, whoa! Like he did what he needed to do to make sure it served the music. Like he didn't get caught up on technique or any of that bullshit. He just played, and he played from a place that only he could play from, right? He is the epitome of being the best you can be, being the best of you, you know, not of anyone else, not being the best, but being the best you, you know. It's like, wow.
So that immediately makes me think of this quote from him. A genius is the one most like himself.
That's Thelonious, man.
Yeah.
That's Thelonious. And if you play like that, if you when you step to a place to play like that, you think you it's for one thing it's scary. So you think the crowd is leaving you. As much as people don't think we pay attention, the crowd would leave, but they're not leaving you. And if you can just trust the process, you'll be fulfilled. They'll be fulfilled. But a lot of times, musicians, they get nervous and they go to that sound note. They do what's familiar, what can get them a clap, instead of really digging in them, and digging inside and playing what they play at home that nobody hears. You know, he did it.
So this. This album cover is drastically different from any of his album covers, right? Would you say that? was there a reason for that in 1968? Is there a story behind why?
I've been trying to find that story. I haven't. I'm like, as a buddy of mine that is like went to school for it. And he's just been busy. He's another bass player, and he's in and out of town too. And he's super like he's like a encyclopedia. And I was like, I've been texting him and trying to get a hold of him. And matter of fact, we work at the same college, and I just haven't been able to get a hold of him. I'm like, what? What is the reason behind this? At this point in time, I believe he's with Columbia Records. I don't know. I know the Baroness is basically his manager, and I don't know if she decided this is the best way to go. These tunes you'll hear, this is done in 68 and 66. You'll be on tour, I believe. You'll see it online, a few videos, and he's playing the same tunes and he's with the same cats. These cats are studio cats from Columbia. However, they did a lot of dates and touring with Thelonious. Yeah, Larry, Ben, and Charles. They did a ton. The vocals that John Hendricks is, that's just for the last tune in Walk Bar. But yeah, all these tunes, Raise Four, So Hip, Blues, it's just like I said, Thelonious is straight down, sounds like straight down the scale. And you know what? When I really like an artist, I'll listen to him. I'll maybe try to figure out a little bit of what he's doing, but I don't transcribe. Like, I don't go through his stuff. I watch him and listen to him because I want the essence. I don't want to sound like him. And sometimes you end up sounding like him anyways, but I want the essence of what he's doing. I want to gather set of the mechanics. I want, or the exact notes. I want to get, you know, what is he feeling? You know, what is he, what does it look like at that time? You know, does he look off? Is he comfortable? You know, because he, at later in his career, he, a prostate bothered him. So I noticed he always got up. I'm like, is he bothered because of that? You know, little things like that you start to think of, because we do stuff, but we don't tell everybody. We just do it, you know. He would get off that piano in a heartbeat. I know he would, he loved to dance, but I'm like, is he uncomfortable or, you know. So, yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's totally inspiring, all that you've said, Walter, and like, you know, your insight into what he's doing and how it inspires you, and how his kind of like tribute to himself and like the ability to trust in himself and his idiosyncratic, you know, brilliance is like inspiring you to take some of those same risks.
I think that's what's missing from music. You know what? In for the last 30 years, right? We've bottled up music, every music that we possibly, every genre we possibly can, and we put it in into academia, and then we charge a lot of money for it for these kids to go. And then we're mad at them when they don't get a place to become professionals, or they get a degree in music and become a nurse or something else. They're not even able to become music teachers because it's not even enough space for that. So I think if we can push more towards the art, we can get more out of it. And I'm a product of that system too. And I just rejected it when I was young, to where I was like, I'll go to school for something different. But I really think when I'm at my best of myself is when I'm really not, you know, trying to flatter or any beautiful lines, when I'm just playing purely from the inside. And if anything we can learn from the masters was they played from a place, there was no school to go to from there. So
yeah,
you know, when they made it up, they made it up, and they bottled it up and gave it to a club that didn't, you know, so they I guess they were broke too, but geniuses, you know. And if we could treat art more from the heart instead of from the head, I think we'll be a much better place.
Yeah, I agree. Is there a certain track you want to listen to right now?
Yeah, Boo Boo's birthday.
Okay. That's track number two.
No. It's the last track on the A side.
Yeah.
Okay.
Track four. All right.
Okay, so Walter just chose to listen to track number four, Boo Boo's Birthday, and I know that Boo Boo was Thelonious's daughter. What would you like to? What else would you like to add, Walter?
Well, you can hear how playful it is when you play. Happy birthday! You know, you can almost see that, right?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I will see that, and you know, and it's been stories of even, you know, him going overseas on the plane, and the band is sitting there like, yo, we don't know what we're gonna play. He comes, it's great, but I can just see him like, I just played a birthday song, you know. Right. I'm not saying he did that, but I can see somebody like, that'll work. Yeah, that'll work. So, yeah. It's pretty hip. Thank you. Absolutely, absolutely. Absolutely. I love how, I mean, what can I say? Essence of the way he played and everything he did was so. One thing I know this probably what they loved about him, even if he was off or whatever was going on in his life, his timing was great. It's two things that make you a good musician. Pitch, playing guitar. You could do those things, you're good. If you can't play in pitch, we have an issue. Mm-hmm. If you can't play in time, we have an issue. He did. So you even see him, he's standing up, and this is in videos, and he's right back in on it. Boom, right back, like right when it's time to go back right into the head again. Or it's his time to solo after the sax solo. It's like, whoa. Wow, he knows where it's at. He knows where things are at, and all those doom. You know, he's creating this space, and the time is still It's still there, right? But with his head, he's creating this. It almost feels like he's an odd meter, right? He's in an odd meter. It almost feels like, oh, he must be like in a five or something right there. No, he's good at making those moments. And, you know, it's space. You know, he would let space happen. You can hear the bass going in, like, man. Makes you feel like, whoa. And then, so, I mean, it wasn't just his harmonic structure. It wasn't the way he played melodies. It was the space. It was the timing. It was this whole package happening. It was like, whoa. And that comes from any type of folk music, you know, very cultural. Because you have to be very in tune to timing, space, and all that when you're dealing with cultures. Latin jazz, any African or from any country, South Africa, Kenya, West Africa, timing is all. I just did this project for Sarah Rodriguez, and she did a whole bunch of Brazil, Africans, and it was all West African stuff. The drummers, it was all time. Time was everything. The dancing was the time. So, coming from any type of folk music, and that even is even European music is folk music. Time is huge, and he just is beautiful. You know.
Is it difficult for young jazz pianists to learn to play Thelonious? His stuff.
I would say yes at first. Then I would say if they come at it with a different mindset, no. I would sit there and try to listen and just play it. I wouldn't try to write it down. I would get the syncopation and just be like, oh, okay, he's playing his type of blues. All right. Those runs, very much soulful, gospel-y type of vibe. Just the different, because his fingers are straight, and it comes down. It makes the piano sound different when it comes down, because of his own technique. Now you can't mimic that, and I wouldn't really tell anybody to mimic unless you really felt that's how you needed to play. But just to get his notes and things that you want to resist, kind of what you learned, and just listen. But you can still use it. You can be like, oh, he's playing the blues. Oh, he's playing. Oh, he's going down. You know, you can still use your ears. And so many people now have played his music to where it's not as foreign as it would have been years ago. But it's still, when you play it, people quite haven't done it the way I you know what I've kind of heard somebody almost sound like it. It's funny. I'm drawing a blank on his name, and it'll come to me in 1 second. Dizzy Gillespie. He was on Mary McPartland. Remember, she did an NPR show for years.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He would come on, and she had him. And he's a good pianist. And he started to play around midnight. I was like, you could tell they had been around each other. Right? And it makes sense. Like, when you were a certain generation, all just sounds the same, right? Like, for pianists, I'm like, oh, he's from that generation. Oh, he's from that. I could tell how he sounds. Or if it's a young dude, it sounds like, oh, he sounds older than what he is. So I was like, that should make sense. Especially you can hear a lot of the older styles in Monk's playing when he does ballads. And he's like striding. He does a lot of, like, and on some of his gigs, he always likes to stride. I'm like, that comes from a certain time period. I think, you know, swing, coming out of swing, stride piano. Yeah, so, yeah.
Would Jelly Roll Morton, would he do stride, or is that earlier?
That'd be a little earlier.
Okay.
That'd be a little earlier. So stride normally started like right 30s and 40s, around okay. Here. Some 50s, you know, 50s going into 50s, you're getting, and remember stride swing is kind of happening all at once.
Okay, yeah.
You know, remember, our Tatum would do stride.
Okay.
I mean, he sounded like his hands were two different people. That's you know. So you still had some bebop cats that would do stride when they would definitely when they would do ballads and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But our Tatum was like, you know. And if you could. And you can see how other things would come out of stride. If you had issues striding and not couldn't stride as well, you see how like my grandmother. Like, it was funny when I was my grandmother played piano too. So when I asked her to play, and I never would see her play a lot. She strided. So that was that. You know, she was born in 1935, I think.
Okay.
So that was the thing. And she would stride playing old gospel hymns.
Yeah. It's interesting. He's grounded in that tradition, but obviously moving on.
Well, yeah, I mean, the only way it's funny, that's why so many musicians are kind of different now these days, because they take music back out of schools, except for like maybe one school in everybody's district. So they have to learn it in their place of worship, wherever they worship or wherever they learn, you know. So a lot of musicians coming out of the church now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, gospel and hip hop and country are three of the biggest genre making around, you know.
Right.
You know, I want a country gig so bad, I don't know what to do. Right. They got 289 dates a year. You know? Oh, man. Like, do you ever see like the country academic class? You don't, right?
Yeah.
You know, it kind of makes sense. It kind of makes you think.
Did you, do you know Chuck Mancuso?
I don't know Chuck Mancuso.
From Buff State?
I met him once.
When I came back from Japan,
took the class.
Yeah, I have the book. Wait 1 second. I have the book. Where is it? Somewhere. Oh, maybe it's up. Oh, here it is. Popular Music in the Underground: Foundations of Jazz, Blues, Country, and Rock.
Yeah,
and that's he makes a big point of, well, you know, you're talking about coming from the church and like folk traditions and how, yeah, that eventually becomes like mainstream popular music. And and he makes a big point of like how, you know, the country and blues traditions, there's some overlap there, which, you know, once it becomes popular mainstream, it becomes marketed and, you know, more stratified, more segregated than it really is. But yeah, he makes, you know, he goes into great detail.
What's his name? Jeff Myers got me in on a Miles Davis tribute to, we did a tribute to Pitches Pro.
We did
like four tunes. Mm. I was in band and Chuck came out, checked it out. That's the first time I met him. That might have been like 2019.
Okay.
But I knew of him. I knew of the book. Yeah. Because I was always, you know, around and everybody would say, have you met Chuck? You know, he's got the glass
door. Yeah, he's a cool guy. He's a nice guy. And I thoroughly enjoyed his class. Dave, is there a tune you want to pick?
I like the intro, the first track, right? Thelonious. Yeah. Should we spin a bit of that?
Yeah, that's one of my favorites.
Okay, so this is track one, just called Thelonious.
A lot of, and the more and more I listen to this, a lot of musicians in my generation right now still that style and that progression. Robert Glasper. Going down the scale. Matter of fact, you'll notice I just put out a short on Instagram, and I didn't realize I'm doing this kind of the same thing too. I'm going down. I'm not even going down. I'm going chromatically down, just hitting the F, just playing like harmonic structures in there. Come circle back around. It's the same. We went back to the recipe because it's good apple pie, and I cook mine different, but it's still apple pie. So. Yeah, it might come out tasting different, which makes me different, but I'm still I mean, you can put a backbeat on that. We're playing the same stuff that he did then. They just didn't. We might be playing more like them than the generation before us, than that heyday 90s generation would, you know. When McBride and all them were young and all those meltdown, down, they might have been playing like some other people, but definitely, you know, I mean, Jason Moran, he done plenty of stuff, you know, in about Monk and different things. So, yeah.
Why would your generation sound more like that than the previous one?
The previous one was all about doing it right. Remember, that was the heyday of academia.
Okay.
So in the 80s, in the 90s, you know, you had people coming out. Remember, you had the Young Lions with Roy Hargrove and McBride, and you had a lot of them cats. And they're all our masters. They're more masters, absolutely. But they played it like it was masters, and they were killing. But it was closer to classical music than it was, and they probably nailed me to the cross for saying this. But they learned everything. Like they are true masters. Like if you ask whatever how he played like what. They could play it. Our generation can do a little bit of that, but we're a little bit more, you know, we have a certain players that we just go with. Monk is one of the players that we love to go after. Some love that Bill Evans vibe. They go after that, you know, with those type of Bill had a certain harmonic structure that people liked. So it all depends. Some really, you know, for me, you know, when you get into it, you listen to the Chick Corea's, then you get to Herbie, you know, and then you finally get to like Monk. You know, I listen to Cooper Moore. He's alive, but I you know, these I go far and far and far more out because I really want to hear. I'm trying to be the best of me, and I try to listen to people that I believe are on the track to be. They're the best of them, you know. So, yeah.
Cooper Moore, that was the guy Cooper you mentioned. Moore. Yeah.
He makes instruments. He does a little bit of everything. He's an incredible cat. I had a chance to meet him 2020, and I sat right behind him. He said, I see you there stealing my shit. I said, yeah, I'm stealing your shit. Yeah. I'm taking it off. So, yeah, definitely.
Now, this was the last recording with the quartet, with this quartet, right?
Yeah. And I want to say this might be the last recording on Columbia.
Okay. And as you mentioned, right, the producer, is it Teo or Teo? Teo?
Yeah. I say Teo. I say it the way that Miles said it.
Okay, Teo. Masu.
It could be definitely wrong.
Yeah. Well, Greg, you know that our mutual friend, Anthony, his son is named Teo, named him after him. Yeah.
That's what I was thinking. It was his nephew. But it's his son. Yeah. We talked about that a little bit. Yeah. Yeah. Mutual friend of ours, Walter, Anthony. He plays tenor sax, right?
Yeah. Yes.
It's been too long. We lost touch. Well, we communicated about 8 years ago, but, good guy, Anthony.
So what? Ozzy. I mean, I haven't seen him in a while, but seems good. So what? Very famous producer. What else is he known for? We mentioned Bitches Brew, right? And like, who else has he worked with? And
well, this producer, probably everybody on Columbia. I don't know exactly. I know. You know, Teo did this. He did Miles. So Miles in that Bitches Brew, you had Chick, I'm trying to let me.
Tony Williams.
Tony was definitely, I don't think Tony made that record. I think that was Jack. I think Bitches Brew was Jack DeJohnette, if I'm right. I think Tony was gone by that time. Him and Tony had a rift. But I think that was Jack. I could be wrong, but I believe it was Chick, Keith Jarrett, Jack. I want to say Gary was on that. I want to say Gary was on it. Gary Bartz. Who else? I'm drawing a blank.
Wayne Shorter. I just went to Wikipedia. Let's see. We're there. Here we go. Wayne Shorter. Benny Maupin. John McLaughlin.
John, that's right.
How do you say this guy? Joe Zawinul?
Zawinul. Joe Zawinul. Joe was on. You know who that? That's from Wayne's band, Weather Report.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
Yeah.
Who played drums?
And you were right. It was DeJohnette. Jack DeJohnette.
Jack. Who else? Was there another pianist on there other than Joe?
You guys, you're talking about Bitches Brew?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, it's Larry Young.
Oh, yeah. Oh, he played organ, too.
He was on there.
He had a lot of cats.
Yeah. I'm looking at it. It's a big list.
Yeah.
He had a lot of cats.
So Teo produced, they just mentioned Bitches Brew and Dave Brubeck's Time Out. So
he produced Time Out?
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
Now Bobby wasn't there yet. Bobby didn't get there till a little later. Dave Brubeck.
Those are two seminal albums and totally different albums.
That's what I said.
From Time Out to Bitches Brew. Wow.
But it's all cutting edge stuff. Remember, Dave Brubeck was the first to start doing concerts at colleges.
Mm-hmm.
He said, "Okay, I'm gonna get the college student," and he really went. That was his audience. That's who he went after.
Why did this quartet break up after this album or shortly after this album?
I believe this particular, it was a few things going on. Charlie, Larry, and Ben, they all worked as session musicians for Columbia. That's one thing. So they needed work. And a lot of them left because Thelonious was having issues. Hmm. And that's why he was losing musicians constantly. He just wasn't getting to work. Then he lost his cabaret card a few different times. It just became hard, you know, dollars don't make sense. Sense don't make dollars, however you want to say it. It's tough. It, they loved him, but they said, I got to go make some money.
What's your understanding of why Thelonious lost his cabaret card? And what does that mean exactly?
Okay, so I'll give an example. Colored Musicians Club, it's a union card. So the Colored Musicians Club was all around the United States. And to play anywhere, you had to have a union card. And New York City, especially, they called it a cabaret card. It allowed you to get into play in a certain type of club, perform. It was basically a license that you had to keep up. A lot of times when you got arrested for anything, you would lose it. So they got caught with some weed, you lose it.
Mm-hmm.
So every time he lost it, he had gotten arrested. And even one time, they get caught up, and Nika says it's hers. It's like $10 worth of weed in the trunk. And that's because he was having a fit. He had an episode. And the hotel called because he was having an episode. Cops followed him, pulled him over. He found, and it went from And then they started whooping up on him because he wouldn't get out. He was holding the stairwell. And it went from that till they opened the trunk. Now it's narcotics. And Nika was like, oh, it's mine. Because she knew she was came from the richest family. You know, she wasn't black. I can beat this before he can beat this.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And she got sentenced 3 years. But she's got a good attorney, got her out on an appeal, and then went back for the appeal and got off on a technicality. So, yeah.
The Baroness. Nice.
The Baroness protected her. I mean, not her, protected him.
Yeah.
But the Baroness, she, because I believe if he doesn't have her, he's dead or in jail very quickly, because he would have episodes that would, you know, and this happens, it's very common in any artist. I can't tell you how many artists go through this. When I teach my class, music industry too, I start off from where your vibrations at. We do from head to heart, heart to head. We talk about mental illness. It's one of the aspects, because artists are the highest mentally ill human beings that are recorded. It'll be the artist that we do it a lot of high highs and a lot of low lows. Mm-hmm. And you've got to put things in perspective. When at one point, you know, and even Dana went on a tour with me one time overseas, 2015. She was like, oh, yes, I see why. You know, you're always the party. Or you're always around. You're what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
You're always, you know, there's some food, there's some accommodations waiting for you. You know, there's always something due next day. It's tiring, but it's always on the move. And when you go from there to having the gigs drop off, you got to work, or you got to do something different, you get a depression, you know. I remember one time I came off and I was depressed, you know, high highs, low low. You got all this, you know, endorphins pushing, and then now you're at home, you know, cutting the grass. So you have to be able to manage yourself. And you got to check in with people when things aren't going well. And then if you need to know yourself. If you can't be out there a lot, then that might, maybe you need to be more education, a teacher. You really have to know yourself, because so many, I can't tell you how many people just went off the deep end, of course, in the pandemic. And why wouldn't you? You know, it stopped the world. So it was tough. It was tough. And so that's how I start my classes. And I try to just sit down and be like, this is the deal. This is what we put in for. You will love the journey. Stop thinking about the destination. Be smart. Watch your pocket. Probably won't be rich, but you have a good time.
Mm-hmm. So your students are all... Or they all hope to be professional musicians?
They hope to be in the industry. So I do, at the biggest major at my college, Villa Maria, is music industry. So a lot of them are producers or songwriters. Even in my piano lessons that I teach at school, at this point in time, when I first came, it was a couple pianists, but at this point in time, all I have is minors, or you know, people that have to take it for their degree. I don't have full-fledged pianists. You know, got one kid who could be one, but he's doing industry, so hopefully he changes his mind. But I think he's a pretty good player. We'll see.
All right, ladies and gentlemen. So we wanted to hear another track from Thelonious Monk's Underground. And I wanted us to listen to Green Chimneys, which is the second track on side B, or song number 6 on the CD. Yeah, I just like the cool accented part at the beginning, the end. Walter, what else would you say?
I mean they stretch out on this. I mean, on these other tunes that we had, they're playing, but they everything is like anywhere from 5 to 6 minutes. But this thing, it almost goes 10 minutes. So, it's like 9 and something. So, they stretch out, and, it's, it has this type of, and I believe this is the one where he's like, he's playing and he's like switching hands in his, on a recording, I believe, you think it's his right hand, but it's really his left hand playing over the right. It's kind of dope. So I enjoy it. This is where he's like truly showing he's, the best of himself.
He
plays with so much space too. Dip. It's so much space. It's just like he lets you. That's another huge thing. You can sing his melodies once you hear it once.
Yeah.
No matter how you feel about it, like he does some. Key things that you teach musicians, it's about the melody. He's nailing that melody,
Yeah.
Every time, all these songs, Boo Boo's Birthday, he's nailing the melody. He's doing what you're supposed to do, when you're conveying this type of song or any type of tune. It's like, what's the matter? So, yeah, he's pretty incredible.
It's a great.
Would you call it staccato? What's like the way he's hitting the keys? Like it's making.
Yeah, his whole approach is probably staccato.
Yeah, right.
Because he's playing like these straight fingers. Like,
yeah,
he makes my technique look like. And I don't have great technique at all, but he has great technique because it is the best for him. It really works. Yeah, yeah, it really works. So he's like you dang. I mean, he's hitting it. He's
yeah.
He's kind of like falling down the piano as he's making those runs.
So
and that and I like when the sax, and we talked a little bit before, Larry Grouse, I like when he starts mimicking what he's playing or playing what he's playing, and it really hits it, you know, bump, 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 banana. And then, but then he goes off on a solo and it's nice. He's, you know, it's
nice. I think you're talking about Charlie, right?
Charlie, Char-
yes. Yeah. Yes.
Charlie is, and you can tell they played with him for a while, so they know him. Mm-hmm. And they, you know, they're like, okay. He, like I said before, the record is cut in 68. But a lot of, we're watching right here, not here, that's the record, but if you, the same tunes they're doing in 66 on the European tour. So they know him. They've already worked and cut some other records with him, because this is coming near his end of Columbia. So he's been working with Columbia since like the beginning of the mid 60s. So they know him. And you'll see at one time, it looks like behind him. It's you can see that it's a YouTube. I wanna say he's in Copenhagen. Hmm. But he might be in Switzerland. Anyways, he's playing a ballad and he sounds incredible. And he's striding, and you can kind of see the band looking at him like, yo, he is killing tonight. Because I'm sure with Monk, they don't know what they don't get.
Yeah.
So he's like, this is crazy. Like, they're like, I mean, they even talk about, you can see the bass player, right? Gales. And he's a killer bass player. He's a session cat. And he was like, you know, he talked about different people playing. You know, what's the name plays on the white keys, and somebody plays on the black keys. He was like, "Well, Monk plays in the cracks." it's a whole other place, you know.
Yeah.
So, yeah, they have some well-tempered. These particular players that are perfect for him. And a lot of people that he was around was perfect in different parts of his band. As far as on the bandstand, they really supported him. You don't want nobody on stage with you that look at you like you shouldn't be there, no matter if it's your worst moment. That's not the guy I need. I need no one to judge me on stage. They need to already have confidence that I'm here. And then from there, let's create. Because that energy can be felt. So if you're judging me, keep it moving. I'm the wrong guy for you.
What did you mean when you said that he plays with straight fingers?
Like that. So you see him do. So if I play like that, it's a certain sound I'm gonna get off the piano. So, and you know, you hear certain pianists speak, maybe you don't. Somebody like, oh, he's got a nice touch. It's because the way he's playing and the way he's pushing down the keys, you get a certain sound from it. You know, some guys like almost play it like it's, you know, or it can have the effect that it's a harp. So they'll kind of play every note just a smidgen off until it ring and rings out, or they play together, or it's, you know, certain. And it always happens with a certain player, the way you know how he sounds, you know. Like my father could play, and I'd be like, "Oh, that's my father playing," because I know how he sounds. I know how he sounds. Like I know his voice, you know. So for Monk, I know how he sounds. Like I know his voice. Like, don't. Oh, that's Monk. Or you could be like, "Oh, that's somebody trying to be Monk." Mm-hmm. The difference, because somewhere they're curving the fingers and they're doing a technique that he just never did.
Oh, really?
Oh. Yeah. And he studied under Mary Lou. For a while, was his mentor, so she probably got him into shape to work. But it looked like he plays this hymn. They got him recorded playing a hymn. I'm like, is that him playing a hymn? And I'm like, he sounds like Monk playing a hymn, but he sounded more like in the tradition of the hymn, I was like, oh, now I completely see where Monk's coming from. As soon as I heard him play that hymn, I was like, oh, I completely get him now. Just could play from the South. Learned how to play in church, you know.
So, Greg, you wanted to mention about Nellie Monk.
We talked about Panonica, benefactor who helped out Monk and the Monk family, and who was his muse for one song. He has a song, well, they call her Nika, right? And
yeah, one song, Nika.
Let's see. I got the albums. Brilliant Corners. So she's got a song, Panonica, on Brilliant Corners. That's this one. But then Nellie on Monk's Music
has a song too.
Yeah, yeah. How do you say Crepuscoli with Nellie?
Crepuscoli.
Yeah.
Jason Moran did a whole big like album kind of tribute. And he looped it around the way, and they put like a little baby don't. It was nice. That's the whole thing right there.
I think the first, it was probably around the time I saw the documentary and first kind of became aware of Monk's music. My parents, who aren't so hip, would listen to, they had some Wynton Marsalis recordings, and he had the one Intimacy Calling, and that's when I first heard Crepuscoli with Nellie, and that one always stood out.
It costs you, doesn't it?
Yeah. I just thought I wanted to, you know, when we talked a little before, we saw the interview with Thelonious Monk's son, and he talked about how, Panonica was like a second mother to him. She was generous to the family as well as to Monk. But, you know, I wanted to give equal billing to Nellie and how, you know, a testament to her to allowing, you know, that to happen and being okay with, you know, their relationship.
I mean, it was, you know, I don't really know the ins and outs. And the ins and outs, I don't know, you know, what even Nellie was, you know, going through. She might have been taking care of him for a while, and it might have just been tough.
Mm-hmm.
She needed to have him well, and she needed him to make a little bit of money so that he could put something towards these kids because they had children.
Right.
So arrangement was made, whatever happened. And Nellie stuck by him too. She was married to him when he died.
Right, yeah.
And he died and living with Nika.
Wow.
So
yeah.
A little different, but it worked. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah. Actually, you want to play a little of that video? Let's see.
Okay, so we'll watch a little of this interview with Thelonious Monk the third. So this is his grandson?
Is there his son?
His son. Okay. So that means Thelonious, the Thelonious is the second. Is that right?
Yes.
Oh, I don't think I ever knew that.
Okay. Yeah.
But he never referred to himself as that.
Okay.
Tell me about the Baroness. She was
the Baroness. Baroness Pannonica de Koenigsegg.
And your family lived with her for a long time.
Yeah, did well, no, let me explain. The Baroness was the granddaughter of Baron Rothschild. This right. is the real Rothschild, not right. a fake one out in the Hamptons or anything, but the real Rothschild. And she came to America in about 1955, 1956. Became very close friends with my father, along with Art Blakey, Teddy Wilson, Gigi Grice, and a number of great musicians. But the friendship that she struck up with my mother and my father became extraordinary. And I think part of it was because she felt Thelonious was the genius of all the artisans in jazz. And I think she realized early on that my mother had two kids, and she had this guy, Thelonious Monk, who was a real package to handle, you know? And she and my mother became best friends. And, you know, I never heard her say it, but I know that in the long run, she decided that she was gonna help Nellie out taking care of Thelonious. And for a long time, it was almost like I had two moms. And I spent a lot of time in her house out in New Jersey. Thelonious did too, because of, you have to remember,
right?
In Weehawken, New Jersey. And of course, Rudy Van Gelder's studio was in Hackensack close by. So it was an easy place to stay if you were recording in Hackensack. And she was so much more than a friend to my father, because, for instance, we would perhaps take my father down to the club for his gig, right? And that'd be maybe 9:30 or 10 o'clock at night. Then myself and the Baroness, sometimes my little sister, but more often than not, it was she and I, we would get back into her Rolls Royce Silver Cloud, and we'd perhaps drive up to Harlem. And she would say to me, and this would be like 11 o'clock, 1 o'clock in the morning, she'd say to me, "Oh, Toot, so-and-so's rent needs to be paid." And so we'd go to their house, and she'd give them the money for their rent. It'd be another time where she might say, "Well, so-and-so's trumpet is in the pawn shop."
These are all jazz.
These are all jazz music. "We've got to retrieve his trumpet because he's a great artist, and he needs his horn." And so we would go retrieve his horn from the pawn shop. And probably my most vivid memory of the Baroness doing what she
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, she would, as we said before, you know, Bud Powell, that whole situation, Bird, that whole situation. These are only the recorded things. You know, musicians, these things, you know, people die with, that she's probably helped countless guys. You know, through whatever they needed. So and so is in jail. I know that too many times. We need to bail them out. You know, can we use you? We need an attorney, you know. So yeah, I could definitely see that happening. You know, it was a tough time. You gotta remember the 60s was turbulent. 50s and 60s were turbulent. Mm-hmm. You know, when I mean turbulent, probably, I mean, what we think is going on now is probably like the 70s compared to what was, you know, 50s and 60s, you know.
Yeah.
50s and 60s, woo! Folk was dying, the streets was hot, and the clubs was packed.
it was good she was put in good use of that Rothschild money.
They were billionaires before we really talked about that.
Yeah,
1940s billionaire. What? You know, they got money that they probably won't even let you know they got. You know, it's just tremendous.
And they said it, I think, on the Wikipedia page, that when she divorced her husband, Nika, you know, that she was, I don't know what they said, disinherited, but no longer, she maybe lost her, but she still obviously had money. They were kind of saying like she was disinherited, but she was far from, there was still
She kept some,
some fun.
It eventually went dry, so that's probably, she didn't get all of what she was supposed to have, most likely. Because she started having money issues right around the end of when Monk was alive.
Okay. But wow, what a, and she was in, so that the record cover, it is a kind of tribute to her. I mean, I guess partly her idea, but she was in the French Resistance.
Yeah, she
fighting trying to fight the Nazis. And you see her image in the back there.
So that's her.
That's supposed to be, I don't know if that's actually her or like a mannequin or a model made to look like her, but it's, I think all like tribute to her.
They say when she enlisted, she ended up going, they ended up sending her the French, she enlisted in the French Air Force. Okay. She ended up going to Africa.
Wow.
They were down there. And right when she enlisted, she said she was a, kind of fortunate because very soon Hitler offed herself.
Mm.
But she still did it, which is
for a woman
to do it, her name must be powerful.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
That was huge when I heard that. I was like, what? So she was a bit of a rebellious, you know,
mm-hmm.
do what I want to do. You know, the way she would fly, she was taught how to, before she got married, taught how to fly planes, and they didn't teach her how to navigate, so she would actually fly low enough to see streets and trains, so she knew where she was at.
Wow.
And she's a bit of a pistol.
So, yeah, Monk was fortunate to have these two strong women helping him out, obviously, you know. In his life.
Okay.
This is Thelonious Monk off the underground album, The Raised Four. And this song is pretty hit because it's just the blues. But just the way he, and I haven't sat down and actually even tried to play it. I've listened to it a ton of times. As I said before, I don't really try these type of artists, my idols, I don't try as much to play their stuff because I'm not really trying to imitate them. I'm trying to kind of be, trying to find the essence of what, but this is a blues, basically. So enjoy. Super hip, a lot of space too. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
He just, you know, not a ton of left. You know, that's what he, not a ton of competent. I mean, maybe one note competent. He's super hip. You know, he's just nailing home this, you know, melody. He just keeps ringing in your ear.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Of course, it's raised four. So guess what he's using raised four every time.
What's the raise? Is that what that refers to, the note?
Well, it's like a suspended, you know, a raise four, and not even suspended because that's a raise three, but a raise four is like sharp four.
Okay.
You know, take the fourth and go a half step up. You know, but that's actually a tune I need to actually sit and play it to really, because I hear it, but I'm like, let me play it to see what he's talking about. Because, it sounds like the lick that he's doing is the raise four, and he's doing over the blues. And so he's got this type of monk harmonic melodic structure while the bass player is just playing blues. Yeah. He's not playing raise, he's just playing blues. So
that's, and when you said it was a blues, that kind of surprised me because the piano is so unblues like, really.
Oh, you know, he plays a ton of blues. I can go through all his catalog from beginning to end. Plays a lot of blues. That is, which will hook you back in gospel. Yeah. But he plays a lot of blues.
Yeah. Yeah, that's surprising because that's like you said, his testament to his genius and following his, you know, his path, because he's not doing a traditional blues, you know, style. Oh, no. You know, he's forging his own path.
He's definitely being himself. I don't know if that's what he heard when other people play blues. Sometimes that happens.
Yeah. Did he grow up in the church, playing in the church? Do you know?
He grew up down in North Rocky Mountain, North Carolina. That's down in 95, right outside of Emporia. It's not far from where I went to school.
Okay.
Richmond. Yeah. But it's down in 95. It's on the other side of, it's over in North Carolina. So he was down there, and that's deep south. Well, we call it deep south when it's country. No matter how high. So it's country down there, and he grew up in a church.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. That was all it was down there.
Yeah,
church, you go and the farm, go to school. You know, and everybody wants to go. You know, that was the biggest thing. You know, the Great Migration. So everybody talking about going to New York. If you're in Mississippi, you're talking about going to Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
Depending on where you were at, but you were going north.
Yeah. And then he made it up to the street, right? And what was in New York City?
Well, his mother took him up there.
Okay.
She moved after I believe his father died, and took him all up there. So, yeah.
Greg, you wanted to talk about the connection to Buffalo.
Yeah. Oh, and here's the. Are we still recording, Dave?
Yeah.
And here's a picture from that Chuck Mancuso book.
Wow. Who was that? Mom, who else is in that picture?
Let's see. Left to right, Thelonious Monk, Howard McGee, Roy Eldridge, and Teddy Hill at Minton's Playhouse.
Yeah. And I want to say all those names sound familiar. I want to say a lot of those are Buffalo Cats.
Oh, wow, really?
I want to say they sound very familiar. I could be very wrong, but I, just being around a color musician club in that museum, I want to say so. especially McGee sounds definitely like I've heard that name before.
Howard McGee, yeah. Roy Eldridge and Teddy Hill.
Could be wrong. Because, you know, you were, I mean, that's how Sabu got picked up. He came through and he needed a bass player.
Yeah.
Picked up right in the Royal Arms. Get picked up just like that. Wow. Oh, let's go. I knew Boyd Lee. I knew Frankie. Frankie was with did some stuff with Monk, but I knew I knew Boyd Lee because Boyd Lee was a friend of mine's stepdad.
Okay.
I didn't know he played until I came back and I was playing at the club. He's like showing me stuff, like, yeah, you know, in this key, you just go up. And he's showing me he showed me harmonic stuff. And I was like, wow, he's showing me all this stuff. And he's like 80-something. And all of a sudden he's like, yeah, you know, will you play gospel? And then he starts playing my father's song.
Oh, wow. And I was
like, what the heck? But he's playing it in a different key. So I'm like, what the freak? And I go to the bathroom when he started playing, like, because I'm trying to think at the same time, like, he's playing like my dad's song. Come back. He was like, are you Dre? That's my nickname. I'm like, yeah, it's my dad's song. He was like, I'm Lorraine's dad. And I was like, it all just rushed back to me, like, oh my goodness. I hadn't seen him in years. It wasn't even years. I had went away to school and had lived in Virginia for a little while. So maybe about 6-7 years. And I saw him and he did that album.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's when I knew Frankie was still alive. He was living in Jersey. Frankie Dunlop. I didn't meet Frankie Dunlop, but I knew Boyd Lee since I was a little boy.
Like, oh, wow.
He used to have this crazy I don't want to say dope or dope. No, he didn't have that back there. He had I'm drawing a blank, but it's very similar. Bouvier. He had a crazy Bouvier in the backyard. It's like a junkyard dog. Just protected house.
Yeah,
bark. It wouldn't bark. He wanted to sneak up on people. So he trained it to shake. Like a toy. He trained his dog not to bark.
Yeah.
I was like, this crazy dog. He's like, no, don't come back here. He'll get you. It's like, oh my God. This is years ago, this kid. He was a heavy chess. He loved to play chess, and I liked to play chess. And I didn't know at that time when we were growing up that he was playing organ up in Canada for a lot of cats. I didn't know he was running because he was working at this crazy place. I didn't know. Yeah. He was out there killing it. And he went to a workshop my dad had and learned his tune. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
That was pretty cool. So, yeah. And then we had a lot of cats. Nkosia, that's what he changed his name to. But Virgil Day. Virgil Day played for Mingus.
Oh, wow.
You had Nasir Abade. Come out of here. He played for everybody. He moved to DC. It was a group of guys in that whole role, you know, in that Sabu era that all played. What's the name is here right now? Guitarist. I'm drawing a blank on these names. It'll come to me in a half a second. Greg Millar. Greg Millar was in that last session before the trumpeter was killed by his girlfriend. Oh man, and to come back in a second. I'm terrible with names if you didn't realize that. Famous trumpeter, not Woody Shaw, but I can't think of his name. He played with Larry Young. He did some tours with Larry Young. He also toured with another organist out there. That's huge. Greg Millar. Yeah, Greg Millar was on the road for a while. with cats. Okay. He's still in Buffalo. He's like chilling too. Same thing with Agusia.
Okay.
So yeah, it's some heavies.
Yeah.
Heavies.
And where I wanted to show that slide one more time, just of Frankie Dunlop.
All right, yeah.
All right.
Connections to Buffalo.
All right, we're back here at Blown Speakers with Walter Kemp III, and Walter was giving us a great history there. His connection with the Dunlop family, with Boyd Lee, who knew most of his life, and Boyd Lee Dunlop, a pianist in his own right, was the brother of Frankie Dunlop, drummer with Monk from 60 to 64. Walter's wife, Dana, before the show, let us know that Monk made many appearances in Buffalo, and his last appearance in Buffalo, was at the Royal Arms, as West Utica near Main Street in Buffalo, 19 West Utica. Some connections. Just a couple connections. A Monk, the classical match. Mash is there. And like Walter said, some Buffalo is not as well known, but some real heavies in the jazz scene and music scene in general from Buffalo. So what do you think, guys, to sum up underground?
As far as for me, it's a glimpse into a genius's journey, mm-hmm. and where he was at, and just an example of what I'm gonna try to shoot for as far as I'm trying to be the best I could possibly be in this art form of improvisation, I don't really even treat it like jazz anymore. I was having a conversation with my wife. I said, I don't play jazz. I've been saying that for years, and I'm really firmly on it now. I play improvisation music. I use everything that I know from hip hop, R&B, especially gospel, rock, blues, jazz, classical, and I churn it up and I spit it out. I don't even really want to be around quote unquote jazz anything. Give me to these other festivals and just music festivals and just let persons, see if they like it. If they don't, So that's where I'm at.
Yeah. All right, Walter. Thank you, Dave.
Yeah, that was fascinating just to hear what you had to say about this album and. Yeah, thanks. And please come back again in the future to discuss more Monk or another artist you're interested in or, open invite.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, thank you. Nice to meet you, Dave.
Yeah, nice to meet you too.
Cool, brother. Yeah.
Walter, you're talking about churning things up and releasing it. So your most recent project now, is Black Hole. And I think we have a photo here.
Yep.
And Black Hole. And actually, Walter, you want to go through the personnel here, please? So I don't butcher.
Problem. Right here was where we were at down in Manhattan. And that's me on the piano. On the violin is Scott Jixier. He's done a lot of movies. Actually, he has his own group out called Scott Jixier, and he's done a lot of work with Stevie Wonder.
Oh, did wow.
Two of them in like 3 years. He's in a ton of movies. Lion King, John Wicks, a lot of that stuff he does. So, and then right here where you have the now you switch, you have to switch Burkhead and Odell. So, well, you probably do. They're the same. They're, so Odell is for the bass player, and he's touring with, right now he's out with Brian Culberson. So he does a little bit of everything, and he's incredible bass player. Brent Burkhead, the reed player, plays with a little bit of everybody. Did a, you know, so many years with is not Lauryn Hill, but yeah, Lauryn Hill, and did Cheryl Pepsi Riley, has his own band I brought here for the festival, Burkhead, and he is an incredible player, and just such a joy to be in the band also. And Alan Metner, just a staple. He plays with a little bit of everybody. I mean, literally, but this particular, we did the tour right here. It was a Jazz Rose tour. We got a grant from South Arts, and we had some time in between a couple of dates. He's playing so much, he went up to like, up in Canada, up to Labrador, back, did a date, came back, did a Rochester date, then came to see, I mean, he's moving around, and just just a consummate professional and really good guy. So I'm happy to have these guys for this project. And they're all from different places, Dallas, Baltimore, New York City, Buffalo, and then, well, Atlanta, Buffalo, and then me. So, yeah.
Wow. What track would you like to play to give people a taste of what you've been doing?
You know, it's whatever one you pick the track. You say you did it. I mean, it's up to you. Whatever track you picked is fine with me.
I was listening. Oh,
give me a second. I'll grab it. Okay, so that does it for episode 74 of Blown Speakers. Okay, Walter Kemp 3, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right, Walter, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, Greg, thanks for hooking this up, right? And
hey, you're welcome. Thanks for manning the board there, Dave.
Mm-hmm. And we're going to go out with a bit of Walter's band, right? Walter Kemp 3 and Black Hole. And Greg, you chose the song Happy Ending.
Yeah, I was listening to this last night, and yeah, just as you'll hear, some very accomplished playing, but it was bringing to mind the Miles Davis In a Silent Way.
Cool.
And I know, you know, obviously Walter's made a strong point about, you know, following his own voice. But it's nice when, for the audience out there, just, you know, they're not imitating anybody, but to give them just a marker. It brought to mind, to me, that Miles Davis record, which is a seminal album. So,
yeah, thank you.
If you're sounding like that, I think that's pretty good.
I think I'm okay.
happy ending is definitely a good note to end on,
right? Yeah,
for our purposes here. All right.
Yes, yeah.
Thanks.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, guys.